I was watching the trailer for the new Channing Tatum Jamie Foxx movie, White House Down. The poster for it looks something like this. Now, if that isn't the most condescending stuff you've ever seen, that reminds me of when things are put in English. And then underneath it, it's put small in Spanish. Like, no, we want to help out our Spanish clientele, but less so. So take a look again. Look at this poster. Equal title up at the top, although of course left is more prestigious than right, but it's equal. But then you got a white guy and a black guy. Oh, look, unity. And then you got the white guy just a step ahead of the black guy, and the black guy looking towards the white guy, as in put the focus on there. The white guy has a gun, the black guy doesn't. Like, I'm gonna protect you because overall I'm in charge. Now, I know what you're thinking because you're weak-minded and want to look for excuses for things. You're saying, that's just incidental, you're reading too much into it. They made this hundreds of millions of dollars movie. And they just happened to do that. They happened to put, it could have been anyone. It could have been a Chinese transsexual, but it happened to be a handsome white guy, a step ahead of a black guy, with their titles about the same. Here's my point. In Hollywood, black people are overrepresented, and here's why. Because there's a certain demographic in our culture that is particularly held down by the status quo as it is, and needs particularly to be sedated by nonsense like Hollywood movies. And that demographic is black people, especially black men. So when I say black people are overrepresented in Hollywood, plenty would right away think I'm complaining. I'm saying that that worm has a hook, as Malcolm X would say. The idea of, hey, look on the silver screen, Hollywood. You can see a whole lot of black, big dick, badass, charismatic cartoon characters. And that's what it amounts to, is Hollywood putting forward this cartoon. They used to put forward in popular media this disrespectful cartoon character version of black people to make white people laugh and maintain the status quo. Now the status quo is pander and placate to a particular to a lot of demographics. I mean, Hollywood is very helpful in numbing the minds of a lot of people who are relatively oppressed, even slaves, but particularly black Americans. And it's really hard not to bite that worm, even though it has a hook. I mean, dude, they're portraying us as invariably badass, big dick, charismatic cartoon characters. And that's what we are, after all. Meanwhile, you're a mess, you're oppressed, and you are sleeping through it because people are giving you compliments as they hold you down. That might be it. Let me just say that back in the day when we had a whole lot of nationalism going on for the United States and things like John Wayne and the Lone Ranger, white people needing some things to rally behind to have a sense of identity and American pride and all that. You had a lot more white people as the badasses. It wasn't really put forward that they were big dick, although nowadays it's just straight out the badass big dick black guy in the movie. Didn't really have that when white people were especially featured. Not that they're not featured now. Again, Channing Tatum is a step in front of the step behind Jamie Foxx, and Channing Tatum has the gun, so it's still the white man's taking the lead. But the overrepresentation of black people serves the purpose of keeping so many who will never be the featured badass, big dick, cartoon, charismatic person. But nevertheless, you can hold out hope. Man, they pay so and so millions of dollars to bounce a ball. they pay so-and-so millions of dollars to brag.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, a touch of the past, present, and future, Vernon and Ryan.
We have been around through many a city and town, but still we can't find out what it's all about. We mean, of course, the girls, the pretty little girls. We ask them once, we ask them twice, they make us feel like mice. Oh, why do they say yes when they really mean no? And why do they stop when they really should go? How can you answer that? We don't know where we're at. We're so confused that we can't tell. We kiss them once, we're under their smell. Oh, why do they squirm when we just try to neck? If they keep that up, we will both be a wreck. We can't stand this much more. We wish that we could score with any one of our little girls. We're growing older with any one of our little girls.
Well, Gus, aren't the folks out there really wonderful?
Ah, they certainly are, Eddie. You know, they give you the feeling of... Well, they give you the feeling of old-time show business.
No, I should say they do. And you know, Glenn, when you talk about old-time show business,
uh-huh,
there's one phase of it that you just cannot overlook.
And that is?
That is the minstrel days.
Boy, weren't those good old minstrel shows wonderful.
Oh, I should say they were. You know, Glenn, minstrels were the daddy entertainment.
That's right. They used to start their shows off with that famous old line,
"Gentlemen, be seated." Right, and performers like that great monologist, Lou Dockstader, would come out on stage and Lou would have a smudge of black on him right up there.
Yeah, and George Primrose had one right down here.
That's right, and oh gosh, there were a host of others. Names and fellas like Honey Boy Evans and Bert Williams.
Yeah, and Eddie Leonard and Al Jolson.
Oh man, you're talking about the tops there. And while we're at it, don't you forget those old end men there.
Oh, those comical end men.
Yeah, Mr. Tambo.
Well, now, what is it, Mr. Bone?
Bart, I want to know, what is all this talk I hear about you having a job in the circus?
Oh, I had me a job in the circus, but I quit there.
You quit there?
Uh-huh.
Well, why did you do that?
Well, I had to do me two jobs at one time.
Two jobs at one time?
That's right.
Well, sonny boy, what was they?
Well, first of all, I had to stick my head through a hole in a piece of canvas, and people throwed baseballs at me.
Oh, my! That must have been hard on your head.
Oh, well, I didn't mind that part of it so much.
Well, then, what was the trouble?
It was the people behind me throwing darts. And, Bart, tell me, what's all this I hear about you buying a cow farm?
Oh, did you hear tell about that? Mm. Well, sonny boy, I bought me a large cow farm. Man, I bought me a cow farm with 99 cows and one bull.
You bought a cow farm with 99 cows and one bull.
That is what I said, son, precisely.
Well, boy, you must be independent.
No, but that darn bull is. But you know, son, you know, the other day, some uncouth individual come by, and do you know what he done?
I know. Tell me, what did he do?
Well, I tell you, son, he done come along, and he went and cut off all the tails on my cows.
He cut off all the tails on your cows.
That's right.
Why, man, that's terrible.
I know. You know what I'm gonna have to do now?
I know. Tell me, what are you gonna have to do now?
Well, boy, I'm gonna have to sell them all wholesale.
Well, why are you gonna have to sell them all wholesale?
Well, I can't retail them.
I love those modern minstrel men.
Man, all I gotta do is just practice bouncing a ball and bragging, and I'll be next up. Think of that as a casino. When people walk into the casino, they know damn well they're not going to break the bank at the casino. They know damn well most people are going to lose all their money. They're just hoping, well, maybe I'll be the one that slides by and gets a pretty big crumb from this casino. Hey, look at this person. They won. You can stick with it. Look at that person. They're a millionaire. All they got to do is bounce a ball. No, no, stick with it. Bounce balls. Meanwhile, buy the jerseys of the people that bounce the ball. Meanwhile, buy the alcohol that the carowlers buy their alcohol, buy their jerseys, and be sure to notice how many badass, big dick, charismatic cartoon characters look just like you. And go back to